Harper Audio presents Wild Justice by Phillip Margolin, read by Anna Fields. Copyright 2000 by Phillip Margolin. Production copyright 2000 by Books on Tape.
Revenge is a kind of wild justice. Francis Bacon. Acknowledgements. Many generous people helped me research and write Wild Justice. My thanks to Janet Billups, Ted Falk, Drs. Nathan and Karen Selden, Claudia Gravett, Dr. J. Mead, Dr. Don Gerard, Marlis Pearson, Rabbi Emmanuel Rose, Carol Byram, Debbie Wilkinson, Maggie Frost, Brian Hawk, the Honorable Susan Svetke, and the equally honorable Larry Matazar, Joseph, Eleanor, Judy, and Jerry Margolin, Helen and Norman Stamm, Dr. Roy Magnuson, Dr. Edward Grossenbacher, Dr. Michael Palmer, Drs. Rob and Carol Unitan, Dr. Stanley Abrams, and Jerry Elshire. Special thanks go to my tireless and relentless editor, Dan Conaway. Every reader who enjoys reading Wild Justice should also thank him. And thanks also to Bob Spicer for useful insights. I also want to thank Jean Nagar for finding me a home at HarperCollins. And as always, thank you to everyone else at Jean V. Nagar Literary Agency. You're the best. And finally, to Doreen, Daniel, and Amy. Thanks for putting up with me. Part 1. Cardoni's Hand. Chapter 1. A lightning flash illuminated the Learjet that waited on the runway of the private airstrip moments before a thunderclap startled Dr. Clifford Grant. Grant scanned the darkness for signs of life, but there were no other cars in the lot and no one moving on the tarmac. When he checked his watch, his hand trembled. It was 11:35. Breach's man was 5 minutes late. The surgeon stared at the glove compartment. A sip from his flask would steady his nerves, but he knew where that would lead. He had to be thinking clearly when they brought the money. Large drops fell with increasing speed. Grant turned on his wipers at the same moment a huge fist rapped on his passenger door. The doctor jerked back and stared. For an instant, he thought the rain was distorting his vision. But the man glaring at him through the window was really that big, a monster with a massive shaved skull and a black knee-length leather coat.
"Open the door,"
the giant commanded, his voice harsh and frightening. Grant obeyed instantly. A chill wind blew a fine spray into the car.
"Where is it?"
"In the trunk," Grant said, the words catching in his throat as he jerked his thumb backward. The man tossed an attaché case into the car and slammed the door shut. Water beaded the smooth sides of the briefcase and made the brass locks glisten. The money. Grant wondered how much the recipient was going to pay for the heart, if he and his partner were receiving $250,000. Two rapid thumps brought Grant around. The giant was pounding on the trunk. He had forgotten to pop the release. As Grant reached for the latch, another lightning flash lit the view through his rear window and the cars that had appeared from nowhere. Without thinking, he floored the accelerator and cranked the wheel. The giant dove away with amazing agility as the sedan careened across the asphalt, leaving the smell of burning rubber. Grant was vaguely aware of the screech of metal on metal as he blasted past one of the police cars and took out part of a chain-link fence. Shots were fired, glass shattered, and the car tipped briefly on two wheels before righting itself and speeding into the night. The next thing Clifford Grant remembered clearly was banging frantically on his partner's back door. A light came on, a curtain moved, and his partner glared at him in disbelief before opening the door.
"What are you doing here?"
"The police,"
Grant gasped.
"A raid. In the airfield? Let me in, for God's sake. I've got to get in."
Grant's breathing came in rapid gasps as he stumbled inside.
"Is that the money?"
Grant nodded and staggered to a seat at the kitchen table.
"Let me have it."
Grant pushed the briefcase across the table. It opened with a clatter of latches, revealing stacks of soiled and crumpled $100 bills bound by rubber bands. The lid slammed shut.
"What happened?"
"Wait, I gotta catch my breath."
"Of course, and relax. You're safe now."
Grant hunched over, his head between his knees.
"I didn't make the delivery."
"What?" One of Breach's men put the money on the front seat. The heart was in the trunk. He was about to open it when I saw police cars. I panicked. I ran. And the heart is still in the trunk. Are you telling me that you stiffed Martin Breach?
We'll call him,
Grant said. We'll explain what happened. A harsh laugh answered him. Clifford, you don't explain something like this to Breach. Do you understand what you've done?
You have nothing to worry about, Grant answered bitterly. Martin has no idea who you are. I'm the one who has to worry. We'll just have to return the money. We didn't do anything wrong. The police were there.
You're certain he doesn't know who I am?
I never mentioned your name.
Grant's head dropped into his hands and he began to tremble.
He'll come after me. Oh, God.
You don't know that for sure, his partner answered in a soothing tone. You're just frightened. Your imagination is running wild. The shaking grew worse.
Oh, I don't know what to do.
Strong fingers kneaded the tense muscles of Grant's neck and shoulders. Now, the first thing you've got to do is get hold of yourself. The hands felt so comforting. It was what Grant needed, the touch and concern of another human being.
Breach won't bother you, Clifford. Trust me. I'll take care of everything.
Grant looked up, hopefully.
I know some people, the voice assured him calmly. People who can talk to Breach?
Yes. So relax. Grant's head fell forward from relief and fatigue. The adrenaline that had powered him through the past hour was wearing off.
You're still tense. What you need is a drink. Some ice-cold shivas, what do you say?
The true extent of Grant's terror could be measured by the fact that he had not even thought of taking a drink since he saw the police through his rear window. Suddenly, every cell in his body screamed for alcohol. The fingers lifted. A cupboard door closed. Grant heard the friendly clink of ice bouncing against glass. Then a drink was in his hand. He gulped a quarter of the contents and felt the burn. Grant closed his eyes and raised the cold glass to his feverish forehead.
There, there, his partner said as a hand slapped smartly against the base of Grant's neck.
Grant jerked up, confused by the sharp sting of the ice pick as it passed through his brainstem with textbook precision. The doctor's head hit the tabletop with a thud. Grant's partner smiled with satisfaction. Grant had to die. Even thinking about returning $250,000 was ridiculous. What to do with the heart, though? The surgeon sighed. The procedure to remove it had been performed flawlessly, but it was all for nothing. Now the organ would have to be cut up, pureed, and disposed of as soon as Grant took its place in the trunk. Chapter 2. The deputy district attorney had asked three questions of Darrell Powers, the arresting officer, before Amanda Jaffe realized that the first question had been improper. She leaped to her feet. Objection, hearsay? Judge Robard looked perplexed.
How could Mr. Dart's question possibly be hearsay, Miss Jaffe?
Not that one, Your Honor. I believe it was, two questions before. Judge Robard looked as though he were in great pain.
If you thought that question was hearsay, why didn't you object to it when it was asked?
Amanda felt fires ignite in her cheeks. I didn't realize it was hearsay until just now. The judge shook his head sadly and cast his eyes skyward, as if asking the Lord why he had to be plagued with such incompetence.
Overruled. Proceed, Mr. Dart.
It took Amanda a moment to remember that overruled meant she had lost. She collapsed in her seat. By then, Dart had asked another killer question. Welcome to the real world, a tiny voice whispered in her head. She had earned an A in evidence at one of the nation's top law schools and had written a note on hearsay for the law review. But she could not think fast enough to make a timely objection in court. Now the judge was certain that she was a moron, and only God knew what the jury thought of her. Amanda felt a hand patting her forearm.
Don't feel bad, girlfriend, Latricia Sweet said. You're doing fine.
Great, Amanda thought. I'm screwing up so badly that my client feels she has to console me.
And were you dressed as you are now, Officer Powers?
Rodney Dart continued.
No, sir, I was dressed in civilian clothes because this was an undercover operation. Thank you, officer. Please tell the jury what happened next. I asked the defendant how much it would cost to have her engage in the sex act she had suggested. The defendant said that she had her crib in the motel across the street and would feel more comfortable discussing business there. I drove to the motel lot and followed the defendant into room 107. And what occurred inside the motel room? I asked the defendant to explain the price of the various sex acts, and she mentioned rates ranging from $50 to $200 for something she described as a night of ecstasy. And what exactly was this night of ecstasy, Officer Powers? Quite honestly, Mr. Dart, it was too complicated to remember, and I couldn't take out my notebook at that time because I was undercover. Darryl Powers had baby blue eyes, wavy blonde hair, and the type of smile Amanda had only seen in a toothpaste commercial. He had even blushed when he answered the night of ecstasy question. Two of the female jurors looked as if they were about to leap the railing of the jury box and tear off pieces of his clothing. Amanda grew more despondent as Powers continued to explain the circumstances leading up to Latricia's arrest for prostitution. Her cross-examination was pathetic. When she was through, Rodney Dart said, "The state rests." Then he turned toward Amanda, his back to the jury, and smirked. Amanda thought about giving Dart the finger, but she was too depressed to defend herself. What she really wanted to do was finish her first trial, go home, and commit seppuku. Besides, Dart had every right to smirk. He was riding roughshod over her. Officer Powers smiled at the jury as he left the stand. All five of the women jurors smiled back.
"Any witnesses, Miss Jaffe?"
Judge Robart asked, but Amanda did not hear him. She was thinking about the previous afternoon when the senior partner in her law firm, her father, Frank Jaffe, had given her Latricia's case and told her to be ready to try it in the morning. "How can I possibly try my first case without interviewing any of the witnesses or doing any investigation?" Amanda had asked in horror.
"Believe me," Frank Jaffe had replied, "with Latricia as your client, the less you know, the better off you are."
Amanda had read over the file of State versus Sweet 4 times before marching down the hall to her father's office, planting herself in front of his desk, and waving it in his face. "What am I supposed to do with this?" she demanded angrily.
"Put on a vigorous defense,"
Frank had answered. "How? There's only one witness, a sworn officer of the law. He's going to testify that our client promised to do things to him for money that I'll bet 95% of humanity's never heard of."
"Latricia can take care of herself."
"Dad, get real. She has 13 priors for crimes like prostitution, prohibited touching, and lewd behavior. Who's going to take her word over the cops?" Frank had shrugged.
"It's a funny world, Amanda."
"I can't try a case this way," Amanda had insisted.
"Of course you can. Trust me, and trust Latricia. Everything will work out just fine if you go with the flow."
Judge Robard cleared his throat, then repeated himself.
"Miss Jaffe, any witnesses?"
Yes, Your Honor. The skirt of her black Donna Karen power suit rode up her long legs as Amanda stood. She wanted to tug it down, but she was afraid that everyone in court would see her, so she stood before the court with her thighs partially exposed and color rising in her cheeks. "The defense calls Latricia Sweet." Before leaving her seat to cross to the witness box, Latricia leaned over and whispered in Amanda's ear.
"Don't worry about nothing, honey. After I swear to tell the whole truth, you ask me what I do for a living, what I said to the police, and why I said it. Then sit back and let me do my thing."
Before Amanda could reply, Latricia sashayed across the room. Her bust and butt were so huge that Amanda was afraid that they would rip her tight red sweater and black leather miniskirt. A blonde orange wig, slightly askew, sat atop her head. Amanda compared her client to the radiant Darryl Powers and moaned inwardly. Since she had no plan, Amanda decided to follow her client's instructions. "Ms. Sweet," she asked after Latricia was sworn, "what do you do for a living?"
"I walk the streets of Portland and sell my body, Ms. Jaffe."
Amanda blinked. The confession was a surprise, but she was relieved that her client was not lying under oath. "Can you tell the jury what happened on the evening of August 3rd of last year?"
"Yes, ma'am."
Latricia composed herself and turned toward the jury.
"On August 3rd, I was working on Martin Luther King Boulevard when Officer Powers drove by."
"Did you know that he was a policeman?"
"Yes, I did."
"You did?"
"Oh, yes.
I've seen Officer Powers run a game on several of my friends.
Then why did you, what happened next? Latricia straightened her skirt and cleared her throat.
Officer Powers asked me if I would have sex with him. Now, I knew what he was trying to do. I've seen him arrest my friends, like I said. But I knew he couldn't arrest me if I didn't mention money. So I told him that I had a room in the motel across the street, and I would feel more comfortable discussing our mutual interests there. Officer Powers asked me what those interests might be, and I described a few things that seemed to perk him up. At least I thought they did, because his face got all red, and I noticed that something more than his temperature was rising.
Two of the woman jurors glanced at each other. What happened then? Amanda asked. Latricia looked at the jurors, then down at her lap.
Officer Powers parked in the motel lot, and we went to my crib. Once we was inside, this is a little embarrassing for me, Miss Jaffe, but I know I got to tell the truth.
Just take your time, Miss Sweet, Amanda advised her. Latricia nodded, took a deep breath, and continued.
Well, like I said, I'd seen Officer Powers around, and I thought that he was about the sweetest thing I ever did see. So young and shy. All those friends of mine he'd busted said he was polite and treated them like ladies, not like the other police. And, well,
yes? Latricia cast her eyes down. When she spoke, her voice was barely audible.
The truth is, I fell in love with Officer Powers, and I confessed my love as soon as I shut the door.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.